Hi, everybody. I think I know most of you, but I am Jennifer Sturza from Story Point, and we have the fabulous Lori here displaying her hats. And I know that we had one last August at Story Point. We'll probably be doing that again, but I know a lot of people asked me to do this, and you guys want it here at Clinton Township, and I'm glad to do it for you. If you don't know me, I'm Jennifer Sturza from Story Point. I'm a registered nurse. I do marketing, I do business development, and I do transitional care navigator. If you don't know what that is, I do everything. So anything you need, call me and I'll make sure it's done. But I do want to thank some of my partners that helped me put this on today. And I'm going to call up Carol. Carol's from Anytime Care. She's amazing. Not only is her business amazing, she's amazing. Taking her out on a Friday night, that's what I'm talking about. Here you go. Here's Carol.
Hi, ladies. I'm Carol Thompson with Anytime Care. We are a private duty home care company, and we help people age in place in their homes. That means that we'll send caregivers to your home to help you out. We got a little literature on the table, so if you have any questions, I'll be more than happy to answer them. And now George from Resurrection.
Yay, George! Yay, yay, yay!
Hi, everybody. I'm George Herodas. I work at Resurrection Cemetery across the street. I guess I don't have to ask who knows about Resurrection, but Resurrection is part of the Mount Elliott Cemetery Association. We're not for profit, so that's why the cemetery looks the way it does. The money comes back in. We're not owned by any conglomerates. It's a private association. We've been running this way since 1841, and I think that's the day I started. It seems that way. I've been there 24 years now. I help the families who walk through our doors. So my literature's on the table. If there's any pre-planning questions you have, if there's ever any questions you have, right, regardless if you're coming to us and you just want to bounce something off of me and have I can give my opinion. If you're told something at a funeral home or another cemetery, use me as an asset. Some people will call me and say, I don't know what florist to go to. You know, I've been in this 24 years, so I would handpick someone I trust for, you know, in the industry. The florist you go to, you might learn he's my cousin, but that's not why I'm sending you there. I'm sending you where I went for my own mother's funeral. There's some relatives I wouldn't send you to. So anyway, I'm George Herodas, and I'm with Resurrection. And if you have any questions, my literature's on the table, and I'm very proud to be a sponsor today. Thank you.
Those two are two of my favorite people besides Lori. But also I want to let you know on the table, I also have May is Hearing and Speech Month. We're doing some hearing testing and some cleaning of hearing aids and I think it's May 3rd, next Tuesday. And then also we are having nonprofit organizations coming into Story Point on May 17th. We'd love to see you guys there. They have a lot of volunteer for seniors and they need seniors to help out with a lot of things that are now opening up. So if you know anyone that loves to volunteer, have them stop by May 17th at Story Point. You have an invite in the little packages I sent out with Story Point brochures. And if you have any questions, I'll be here the rest of the day, and I'm sure I'll see you guys again soon. But now, here is Lori, our hat lady. Yay!
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Lori Hoffman, and I collect hats. I've been collecting hats for approximately 30 years. I started out with 5. I stopped counting at 1,000. I figured it was kind of silly to keep going. But that was 2 years ago, so who knows how many I have now. But I brought a few of my favorites to start. It's just kind of an open forum. If you have any questions, kind of, you know, just raise your hand, speak out. We'll talk and we'll have fun. And that's the main thing, is we're having fun. But we're going to start out with Catherine. We start out with Catherine, and she's wearing my first hat. And I don't mean the first one I bought. I mean the first one that my mother bought me for Easter Sunday, 1965. She bought it in downtown Pontiac at JCPenney. It's made of cardboard, and if you look very closely, it has this beautiful pink plastic tulip. My first hat. Here's Sue. Sue is wearing an 1870, 1880 fine Italian straw with dove wings. The silhouette of the day was almost what she's wearing, very tall and very thin. No bustles in sight. Here's Linda. Linda's wearing an afternoon hat made of horsehair or crinoline. This comes from England. It's one of the newest additions to my collection. 1900, 1901. If you look very carefully, it has purple martin birds on it. They're two millinery birds, taxidermied birds. And it is perched on her head just like it would have been if the lady was wearing it. Judy's wearing a transitional hat, little evening bandeau, gold lame lace, egret feathers, 1919, 1920. Era. Young ladies would have cut all their hair off and had really cute short hair. Jan's wearing another 1870s, 1880s stovepipe hat, rough Italian straw, ostrich feathers, silk ribbon. Here comes Gail. Gail is wearing an afternoon hat. 1903, 1905, velvet poppies, and if you look very carefully, there is a bird of a black bird of paradise from Papua New Guinea. Sue's next. Sue is wearing one of my favorite hats. It's another transitional hat, about 1916, 1918. Made of polypropylene straw, and once again, these wonderful wings of a bird of paradise. There are 34 subspecies of birds of paradise. At the time, they were endangered. They are no longer endangered, but this is why we have the Audubon Society. I wear this hat when Catherine and I go to vintage hat shows and stuff, so she can find me, because you can't miss me in that hat. Catherine's wearing a lovely winter ensemble. 1895, made of ermine. And if you look very carefully, there is a real ermine there. Yeah. Young lady would have gone skating out on the pond or walking with her beau. Another afternoon hat, 1903, 1905. Polypropylene straw and ostrich feathers. You'll notice as we go along, there's lots of feathers and flowers. Linda's wearing an afternoon hat from the 1950s. This was about the time that Gone with the Wind was put out again in the theaters, a reissue. Everybody wanted a plantation hat. I have this one strictly because it has hot pink roses on it. People ask me in the past, well, how do you know what to collect? And I say, well, usually it calls to me. Lori, buy me. So I do. Another afternoon hat or promenade hat. 1905, 1908. Rough Italian straw and an ostrich feather and a lovely brass buckle. Now, I showed you the hats from Papua New Guinea. The Audubon Society, though, that injured the bird. Ostriches drop their feathers. So there's no danger to the bird. There was an ostrich bird farm in Pasadena, California, that at one time had 50,000 ostrich on it running around. Jan's wearing an evening hat, 1903, 1905, silver and gold lame, and another bird of paradise. I didn't realize I have like 30 birds of paradise hats. They call to me. Gail's wearing a say something hat. Laddie Northridge, Los Angeles, California, the 1940s. Can't you see Betty Davis or Joan Crawford walking down Hollywood Boulevard with that? It's black felt with felt geraniums. Sue's wearing a 1930s hat, little bucket hat. I call this my everything but the kitchen sink, because literally there's leather, there's gold lamé, there's velvet, there's ribbons. I would love to see what the woman wore with this hat. It's fabulous. It just is one of those great, cute little hats. I'm sure you ladies have seen My Fair Lady. I swore up and down that when I got a hat that someday I was going to have a My Fair Lady hat. I'm still on the lookout. If a costume ever comes available, I'll sell my soul. But this is a lovely original, 1903-1904. You really don't fit through the doors. It's plush or beaverette. Pheasant feathers. Sue has the hat on backwards. There we go. A lovely transitional hat, about 1916, 1918, with dyed feathers, black velvet, lovely little ornament. A young lady's fall hat, 1905, 1908. Plush or beaverette. When I'm saying plush or beaverette, it is actually felt that has been shredded to make it look like fur. So these were the original faux furs. Judy's wearing an afternoon hat made of black plush or beaverette and these great dyed ostrich feathers. Can you imagine the outfit that young lady wore? Here comes Jan again. 1905, 1908. This is a milliner's bird in combination with a taxidermied bird. This is an African starling. Iridescent green and blue feathers. We're getting into the point at the time that these hats were getting bigger and bigger. They had a series of satirical postcards about women that couldn't get on, you know, sitting in front of you and couldn't get on the streetcar and things like that because the bigger the hats. Another little afternoon hat. It's made of cardboard and velvet. This one is unfinished. I'm not quite sure what to do with it. I think I might find some period roses and add some of my own flowers, but I couldn't pass this up. The lady didn't know what she had. She charged me $10, so I had to have it. Now, give me a little backstory. Yes, ma'am. Where do I find them? I find them on eBay. I started out, actually, real quick backstory. I moved out of my parents' house into my own house. Didn't have enough stuff. Saw a picture in Country Living magazine of a hat rack with some hats. I said, I can do that. So I went to an antique store and bought a couple hats. And borrowed, don't tell my mother I haven't returned it, her cup rack. And then I found eBay. I now have all the hats, but yeah, I've been collecting almost 30 years. Sue's wearing another afternoon hat. This would have been called in Ladies' Home Journal, a hat for the mature woman. Every month they came out with hand-drawn pictures, like, you know, nowadays they take a photograph. Back then it was a hand-drawn picture of six or seven of the newest hats. So a hat for the mature lady. Another bird of paradise, 1890, 1895. Beautiful rusty brown velvet and a bird of paradise. Another transitional hat, 1916, 1918. Yes, ma'am. We're going from the huge hats that were this wide to the little tiny cloches of the 20s. I only have a few cloches and I didn't bring them. But yeah, so this is going from huge and wide to thin and tall. Yes. Okay, Linda's wearing what I consider in my, we don't tell my family. I bought this hat, I had to have it, okay? Back about 15 years ago, it was four car payments. I will not tell you how much I paid for my each month's car payment. But I have since beaten it. I have one on layaway. I have one that I recently purchased from London that was 900 pounds. So, about $1,200. It's rough straw. It's rough straw, horse hair. But I had to have it. Once again, it's one of those ones that called to me. But this little hat makes up for it. This little hat was $10. Same time period, the lady didn't know what she had. It's black velvet over cardboard with a crocheted ribbon. Jan's wearing another lovely 1905-1910. It's lovely plum velvet, and it would have been tipped back on her forehead so that you could see her face. Another afternoon hat, 1900, 1905. This young lady would have had a massive amount of hair. This hat would have sat right on top of your head, had it held on by a hat pin. We must admit that no young lady ever had problems with a masher on the streetcar with his 12-inch long steel hat pin. Sue's wearing another one of my lovely bucket hats, 1903, 1905, velvet and gold lame. Quick story about this one. My friend Ken from Texas met him at a show in Chicago. He says, Lori, you should see the hat I just bought. I just bought it. I said, okay, well, let me see it. So he went and paid for it. He had it on, you know, on hold. Brought it to me. I saw it. I'm like, okay, I have to have it. The man owned the hat for 4.5 minutes. He said, that's the quickest sale I've ever made. Catherine has a problem. There we go. It's so floppy because she doesn't have enough hair. This would have sat on top of a Gibson Girl hairdo. These are called waterfall ostrich feathers. If you look very carefully, the ostrich dealer has hand-tied ostrich feathers together. Each individual feather is hand-tied to make it longer and bigger and fluffier. A lot of work. These are waterfall ostrich feathers. A cute little day hat, 1895 from Germany. Fine straw. Great flowers. And I don't collect anything really for the value. I collect it because I have to have it. I need it. Listen, I don't drink and I don't smoke. So if anybody knows of a Hat Collectors Anonymous meeting, let me know. A lovely chapeau. 1904, 1905. Now, the young lady that wore this might have been taken for a Sunday drive in an automobile, and she would have had a huge amount of tulle cloth holding this on her head so it didn't blow away in the wind. Bronze velvet, yep. An afternoon hat, 1905, 1910. Maybe worn for a promenade on the Jersey Shore or Brighton in England. Rough back, maybe. Yes, the Belle Isle Casino. Except this one is English. A second stage mourning hat. When I call it second stage, I mean the young widow would have worn this after 366 days of widowhood. It's not completely black. There is a blue ribbon, so that's how I can tell. It's made of polypropylene straw and egret feathers. Victorian and Edward is about 1910, 1912. Victorian and Edwardian women had very strict rules to wear. An evening hat for the mature woman, 1900, 1905. Maybe out to see a show. Sue's wearing another afternoon hat, 1910, 1912. French silk ribbons and a great brass buckle. A promenade hat. 1903, 1905. They were getting wider. Black and blue velvet, ostrich feathers and egret feathers. A late teens hat, 1916, 1918. The war was on. They were using less and less materials. But this milliner really had a way with flowers. And it's all beaded on the black velvet. A lovely afternoon hat, 1908, 1910. Yes, ma'am. It's all original. Some I do have to do a little nips and tucks with thread and needle. In fact, I have an entire closet full of hats that need to be repaired. And someday Catherine's going to help me. Judy's wearing a great hat. I love this hat. I found it on a trip to Virginia. And I was in a little town in West Virginia, and this was sitting there, and it didn't have a price on it. And I thought, oh, I need this hat. So I went up to the dealer. It was a mall, like an antique mall, and I went to the dealer, and I said, I need this hat. He says, oh, well, let me call the dealer. So I'm standing there waiting and waiting. Come back, Judy. Judy, come back. I'm waiting and waiting, and she gets hold of the dealer, and she says, well, it really was part of the display, but if you really want it, she'll sell it to you. $25. I grabbed the hat so fast, threw my money at her, and ran out of the store, and was told I was never to come back. I must have scared her. But it's lovely. It is leather and velvet, and if you look very carefully, human hair. But I had to have this hat, so. I take empty suitcases wherever I go. Jan has it on backwards. A lovely little pre-cloche, 1918, 1919. One of my better bargains. Like I said, I make up for the hats that I pay £900 for by getting this lovely little one for $6.50. Because she didn't know what she said had. She said, old hat. And I'm like, okay, after I paid for it, I told her. No, I was polite. Gail's wearing a bucket hat for the mature woman, about 1900, 1905. It is. The milliner went crazy. But I just love hot pink roses, so. A lovely afternoon hat. Early Edwardian, 1903, 1905. That could be worn now. Yeah. Catherine's wearing a cape line, 1900, 1901, brown velvet. Chocolate brown velvet. One of my oldest hats. Little poke bonnet, 1850, 1855. Sheared silk. Yeah, this is pre-Civil War. another lovely hat from my friend Ken in Texas. This one he owned for more than 7 minutes, so that's okay. It's lovely lavender plush or beaverette, French silk ribbon, ostrich feathers, and glass grapes. Judy is wearing a lovely repurposed 1903 hat. During the Second World War, there was a booklet came out that told women how to repurpose their hats. So someone in the 1940s during the war wet this down, folded it up, and made it a 1940s style hat. But originally it is 1903, 1908, fine Italian straw. I had to do a little research on this one and find the booklet, but yeah. Thank you, President Roosevelt, for having us do all this. Okay. Catherine is wearing the oldest hat in my collection. It's from 1780, from the Bavarian Alps. It's called a Regelhab. Regelhab. This is a widow's hat. If you were a young, unmarried woman, you wore silver, and they were glass beads and actual silver thread. If you were a Frau or married, you wore gold. If you were a widow for the first 366 days, you wore complete black. After day 367, until you found another husband. Now, the thing is, if you were a man, you were expected to marry again, quickly, because no man can do without a woman. If you were a woman, you had to wait 366 days before you could even begin courting again. But this is second stage because it has lovely blue beads. It's all on cardboard. It would have been held on her head like it looks like a bow, but with stainless steel, not stainless steel, but steel hat pins that were U-shaped. It would have gone into her head, yes. Actually, I just asked if you heard her, she had 4 car payments. This lovely hat, which has been appraised at $900, cost me $27 because the person didn't know what it was. They said cardboard hat. I'm like, okay, if you want to call it a cardboard hat, you go right ahead. It's not for sale, by the way. Jan's wearing a lovely hat. I call this my everything but the kitchen sink. The milliner went crazy on this one. There are jet beads. There are ribbons. There are ostrich feathers, dyed and natural. There are beads and hat pins. About 1895, 1900. Can you imagine the young lady walking and her lovely ostrich feathers flapping in the breeze a little bit and the men were following her? Mm-hmm. A lovely afternoon hat. Once again, transitional, about 1916, 1918. Would have sat up on a bunch of hair and tipped forward a little bit and been held on by a hat pin. These are pigeon feathers, also called gora, bleached out. These would have been, the actual bird is gray. A little pre-cloche, about 1918, 1919. This is from Australia. Someday I'm going to get there and buy my own, but I had it shipped. Originally, if I have a 1900 Sears and Roebuck catalog, you could usually buy a hat similar to this for $5 to $25. It was a lot of money back then, yes. Catherine is wearing a Lily Dachet. Lily Dachet came from Paris in the 1920s and was a milliner to the stars in Hollywood. I always assumed, and maybe your mothers and grandmothers could tell you, hat in the 40s was probably, what, $5, $10, $20 at the most? Okay, down at J.L. Hudson's. Lily Dachet hats were $95 to $125 in the 40s. So this is a lovely Lily Dachet. It's a lovely turban, about 1900, 1903. Copper lamé, egret, bird of paradise feathers. Style, I can't prove it, there's no label, but it's styled by Paul, after Paul Perreault. He was on the Rue de la Paix. He was a contemporary of the Charles Frederick Worth gowns. Women at that time, the 400, the Astors, the Guggenheims, went to Paris, their wives, I should say, and their husbands came along with a checkbook. And they went down to Worth's or Perreault's, and they bought their clothes. Then they went down to Carolyn Ribot's or Mademoiselle Georgette and had their hats made. Another Lily Daché, late 1930s, early 1940s. Hard felt, and the ostrich feathers have been burnt to give them that wispy air. Judy's got one of the newest additions to my collection. It's from England. 1914, 1915. Ombre dyed ostrich feathers. Jan is wearing one of my favorite hats. I've had this hat for a few years, and it just took me until last hat show to figure out how to put it on her head. I'm a little embarrassed, but I found a picture. It was an actress named Carolyn Clifford, 1903, 1905. She wanted people to see her face. So she wore all her hats tipped back on her head so that her beautiful face showed. Everybody else followed suit, because if you were anybody who was anybody, you wanted to look like Carolyn Clifford. So 1903, 1905, more waterfall ostrich feathers. I think I told you when Catherine was modeling the lovely wide My Fair Lady hat. This is as close as I can come to Ascot opening day. Black and white, plush beaverette. It's a huge hat. Sue's wearing another afternoon hat. 1905, 1908. Black velvet, ostrich feathers, and those wonderful roses. Catherine's wearing a lovely showgirl hat from the Moulin Rouge in Paris, 1895. Beaded puppy dog ears. My friend who sold it to me lives in Long Beach, and she has 27 of them that she's been selling. This is one of the fanciest ones with the tail. So this might have been this one of the lead dancers at the Moulin Rouge. Another little day hat from Australia. It's made of gabardine. 1916, 1919. We're getting more conservative as the war goes on and things are running out. We didn't want to be ostentatious. An afternoon hat, 1916, 1918, polypropylene straw, lovely coral colors, and a lovely bone little buckle, kind of a pre-cloche, a promenade hat for the mature woman. Well, to tell you the truth, in about 1916, 1918, the life expectancy of a mature woman was probably about 35. Violet Crawley would have worn one of these. Yes, ma'am. The amount of the material it's made of, so more velvet and silks and satins for evening. The straw for the day, unless it was a lacquered straw, but yeah. Now, the ladies are going to come out together. Catherine and Judy. Catherine is wearing a Carolyn Ribot, 1910, 1912. Carolyn couldn't make money by only serving the wealthiest of the wealthy who would come, you know, on the Lusitania or something to Paris and have a hat. So she licensed her name to other milliners. And so they would make a hat, like Judy is wearing, that would say, by permission of Carolyn Ribot. Yeah. So both original hats, but one is original Carolyn Ribot, and one is an authorized copy. Both about 1910, 1912. Carolyn Ribot, you probably would have paid, at that time, Mr. Guggenheim might have paid about $50, $75, which is nowadays $500, $600, $700. The copy was probably about $12, an American milliner. But she made her money by having them pay for the licensing and pay for the materials. Very smart. Carolyn Ribot was a very smart lady. Another mourning hat, a bucket style, 1900, 1905. It's wire covered in crepe. Sue's wearing an afternoon hat, 1916, 1918. Lovely velvet. Another Carolyn Ribot, 1900, 1905. Made of hard plush or beaverette. Feathers. The question was, when did they stop using the birds? The Audubon Society became very prevalent about 1900, 1903, and they passed laws for the reduction of the exotic birds. So I've seen pictures with whole owls on them and entire birds and things like that. And so that's why you see more, after that time, more ostrich feathers, more rooster feathers, more chicken feathers and things like turkey feathers, because they did not, either they didn't harm the bird or the bird was destined for their dining room table anyway. Yes, ma'am. I do have a peacock coming up. Linda's wearing a lovely cape line, 1919, 1920, silk georgette, these great flowers. Yes, ma'am. The brims were on either wire or straw underneath the silk or cardboard. Yes. There, yes, buckram too. Yes, ma'am. Teach me something. Another afternoon hat. I got this from Canada. Chantilly lace, black satin, these great roses. This is another one that's told me to buy it. I have a hat budget monthly. I try to stick to it. We'll ask my business manager how I succeed. There's a slush fund. Not many people have a hat slush fund. Jan's wearing a hat for the mature woman, 1903, 1905. Stiffened black, royal blue velvet, silk ribbon, rooster feathers, turkey feathers, and peacock feathers. A promenade hat, 1905, 1910. rough Italian straw. The Italians made the best straw. People imported it. Once again, just promenading on the Jersey Shore. Sue's wearing a lovely afternoon hat. Emerald green plush. Iridescent hat pin and steel mesh ribbon. '1903, '1905. Fine Italian straw. Absolutely fabulous lilacs. I have this on my Pinterest pages under Lori's Hats, and a friend of mine from Oklahoma says, "Will you sell that to me?" No. He wanted to trade. He had a beautiful Edwardian dress and he wanted to trade, and this is one of my favorite hats. But it is in my will that he can have it when I'm gone. A lovely afternoon hat that she's got on backwards, I think. This one I'm not sure of. When I say it's on backwards, most hats, 90% of the time you can hold it and read it. This is from the Mander brothers in Chicago. So she did have it on right, but she doesn't quite have enough hair to hold it up. '1916, '1919, silk and paper roses. Okay, now I'm going to start singing the Marie Osmond song. Sorry. A lovely hat from a lovely millinery store called Fleur de Paris in New Orleans, Louisiana. It was bought for the Kentucky Derby, 1955. Apparently the lady decided she didn't want to wear it because the price tag is still in it. It was $195 in 1955. That is polypropylene straw. Imitation, yeah. Okay, Judy is wearing what I will admit is a mistake, and I don't admit that very often. It taught me a big lesson. This was worn to Ascot opening day, 1933. I bought it from the owner's daughter. She had a lovely picture on eBay. I had to have it because it was pink and it was flowers, and I didn't ask how big it was. She had it on a little tiny head. I didn't realize it was a little tiny head, so I didn't. I was assuming it was a huge hat. But it's adorable, and it's cute, and it's pink. So Ascot opening day, 1933. I was asked if I had any hats from the 60s. My cutoff point is the late 50s. When I started out collecting, I did have a few pillboxes, so somewhere in a tote, in a closet that I haven't seen in 18 years, are some Jackie O pillboxes. They're a little young for me. Catherine's wearing a lovely afternoon hat. 1903, 1905, the milliner took some steam and made the egret feathers into a heart. I flew to Long Beach, California to buy this hat. I had to have it. I saw it in an advertisement for a show in Long Beach. I got to there. I left my friend who was accompanying me. I ran to the booth and literally bought this hat in about 5 minutes. And I said, I came specifically for this hat. I have to have this hat. It's rough straw, but I love the little heart. Jan's wearing a lovely afternoon hat, 1903, 1905. You look very carefully. There is a milliner's bird. It is supposed to be a little tiny owl. But this, a milliner's bird, the milliner would have taken chicken feathers, turkey feathers, and made them into a little bird. So there's no taxidermy in this. It's just on a cotton pad. They've hand sewn all the things and put little glass eyes so it looks like an owl. It's a widow's hat. about 1908, 1910. This poor widow didn't want to wear yards and yards of veil, so she hid her tears behind a waterfall ostrich feather. Silk velvet and great ostrich feathers. Another little German hat, 1900, 1905, a hat for the mature woman. There was a woman in Chicago who was the end-all, be-all of Chicago matriarchs, and her name was Carolyn Palmer. And she had a beautiful head of silver hair. I can see this on her as she went to her ladies' aid societies and teas and things. 1903, 1905, lovely royal blue plush or beaverette. Plastic grapes, so they had learned industrialization and made primitive plastic. Hand-beaded buckle. A suffragette hat, 1916, 1919, with the colors of ivory and purple and green. Other suffragettes would know that she was with them for votes for women, without maybe the men in her family knowing. Ribbons, jewelry, anything they could to advertise that, yes, they believed in votes for women. Specific colors, ivory, purple, and green. And I'm sorry to say, I feel really bad that I don't remember what they're for. Purity and steadfastness and something else. But yeah, the three colors are very specific. And I promise by the time I get to the next show, I will know what they mean. Yeah, every woman that was a suffragette had something that showed that she backed the movement. It could be a ring with pearls and peridot and amethyst, thank you very much. And so every woman had something that said, here I am, without advertising and going, votes for women. Very subtle at the beginning.
How many hats like that do you own?
I only own one suffragette. Yeah, one. Yep, I've been lucky enough to find the one. A lovely afternoon hat. 1900, 1905. Black satin over wire and mesh. Just a really cool hat. Kind of a little bit, but more hot pink. But yeah. Just once again, it called me. I'm getting an unlisted phone number. Another Follow Me Boys hat. 1900, 1905. Egret feathers. You look very carefully. The milliner has hand-painted hundreds of little white dots on the feathers. Miss Catherine is a widow. A very wealthy widow. About 1905, 1910. The veil on that, I did take it out once. It's 6.5 feet long of silk crepe and a mink stole. His little face and tails right there. No. Two different time periods. The mink stole is about 1890. My Christian Dior. This is my youngest hat. It's about 1959. I call this my mother of the bride. I can see the woman being escorted down the aisle wearing a pink coat and matching, or dress and matching coat and dyed to match shoes as she's escorted down. Yes, my Christian Dior. A day hat, 1880, 1885, rough straw, and pigeon feathers. It is missing its ribbons. She's having to hold it on. It would have had a ribbon tied under her chin. But the ribbons are missing. So yes, it would have sat way back on the back of her head. She would have had a pretty good size bustle. In fact, the saying at the time was, the smaller the hat, the bigger the bustle. An afternoon hat, 1903, 1905. I would love to see the outfit that went with this. When I say that, I mean because I also collect vintage postcards. The postcards are technically brown and white, so you can't see sepia toned. Okay, you can't see what the outfits are, but I just can't. A royal purple gown, it must have been fabulous. Another one of the oldest hats in my collection, 1855, 1859, rough straw, beautiful ribbons and roses. Now the young lady, think Scarlett O'Hara, a beautiful crinoline dress that Scarlett O'Hara would have worn. Had approximately 48 yards of fabric in each. Linda's wearing a lovely afternoon hat that I was lucky enough to purchase from the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York City. Silk over cardboard. I think it's muskrat, I'm not sure. Some fuzzy creature. But every once in a while, the museums around the country will deaccession their collection, and I've been lucky enough to purchase some. Another widow's hat that Judy's wearing, stovepipe, 1870, 1875. There's a little tiny pre-plastic called gutta percha. Little emblems on there. I'm not quite sure what they mean, but they must have meant something to her. There's a half moon and some bars, so something with her husband. It depends on what time of mourning there was. Usually you only wore a veil the first couple of months. Another lovely afternoon hat. 1905, 1910, rough straw. Silk ribbon. Gail is wearing a lovely little hat that my family calls the scared chicken. The scared chicken. They're wrong. It's turkey. This lovely little hat I bought in Ohio. The lady that sold it to me told me it was her mother's for her wedding. 1940. Apparently the groom had the audacity to tell the bride that she wasn't going to wear that. I said, oh, I'm so sorry. Then she said, well, my mother told him, you wanna bet? She wore it. Then the young lady went on to say that my mother usually won every single argument they had in 59 years of marriage. More power to her. A bucket hat for the mature woman, 1900, 1905. Rough straw and paper and cotton, roses and leaves. You ladies have seen the movie Titanic. Everybody's seen the movie Titanic. This lovely hat was bought from the woman who costumed the Titanic. It was in the scene where they're having tea in the dining room. It did not make it into the final cut. It ended up on the cutting room floor, but I was able to purchase it from her estate. It is all original, 1910, 1912, rough black straw, silk ribbons, ostrich feathers, lovely little flowers, yes. It didn't make it on into the scene, but she did costume the movie. I was very happy. Little afternoon bonnet, 1875. Made of crinoline or horse hair. They actually took real tail feather or tail hair from a horse and wove it into the in with a straw. The young lady would have had her hair pulled back in a huge bun tucked in right there. That's why there's a dent in the back of the hat. That was during those years they had huge buns, and if they didn't have enough hair, they wore a switch. Another Follow Me Boys hat. 1900, 1905. Catherine's wearing an afternoon hat. Black velvet. Leather poppies. Gail is wearing another one of my favorite hats. In my rich fantasy life, the gentleman in Oklahoma went out and caught this, trapped it. His wife made it into lunch. I think it's a muskrat. There's a foot attached. Then she got her handy-dandy Sears and Roebuck catalog and ordered a wire frame for nickel and a piece of velvet for 25 cents. That lovely rose in my Sears and Roebuck catalog is 17 and a half cents, and she made a hat out of it. So they ate it for lunch, and not sure if that's true, but I like that fantasy. It is all handmade from Oklahoma. Another lovely hat from the Metropolitan Museum. Plush or beaverette. An afternoon hat, late 1930s, early 1940s. Laddie Northridge of Hollywood. Rosie the Riveter, maybe, wore it. Linda got away from me. She's wearing a promenade hat, about 1903, 1905, fine Italian straw. And roses. In most couture shows, they end the show with a wedding dress. I end my show with a showgirl hat. This is the lovely Jennifer. Jennifer is wearing a showgirl hat from the milliner Reggie Augustine. The young lady wore this and not much else. A few well-placed sequins. It is polyester over wire. There are pipe cleaner butterflies and bumblebees.
You guys do not put that on him.
This, I will tell you. I will tell you, ladies, I love this hat. I bought this hat. I didn't know what it was. It was $15. It's very heavy. She charged me $25 to ship it to me, and as Jennifer can attest, it is extremely heavy. It has been appraised at between $5,000 and $7,500. Now, if anybody wants to write me a check, that's the going price. But I would like to thank my models. Let's have them out here. Catherine, Linda, Sue, Judy, Jan, Gail, Sue, and Jennifer for having me, and you ladies for being so kind. Thank you, ladies, very much. And thank you, Jennifer, for having me.